Well, thank you for this possibility to give a short presentation and introduction further to scenario building. We had already an earlier session, and well, what we are going to do is now basically going step by step how to build a scenario to strengthen your business continuity, because nobody knows how this future will look like. Yeah, that is impossible to predict the future, but there is one tool, one method to do that, and it is called scenario building. What I will do during this presentation is a combination of a PowerPoint and an Excel spreadsheet, because the PowerPoint will show, let's say, more the generic overview, like what am I going to tell, and I will show then in Excel how that works out. You will, of course, get the Excel. It's quite an extensive Excel, but I thought it was wise to go with you through this Excel, and based on the questions and any other topics, it might be possible, of course, to adjust it according to what is raised during this presentation. So, and as said already, if you have questions, just put it in chat box and we'll come back to it later. Okay, what is scenario building? Well, scenario building is basically, like I said, predicting the future is very difficult. So that's what you have to think is, what if this happens? What if that happens? What if that happens? And how will it work out in my microfinance institution? So basically, and it's a little bit rehearsal of the last time, but I will quickly make the connection to the Excel, but then you know what I'm talking about. We talked already about three main factors to build a scenario. One is you have stakeholders. So stakeholders can do things. They can be a help, but they can also be a risk. That's one. Secondly, there are macroeconomic events, like the interest goes up or the interest goes down, or the foreign exchange rate goes up or down. So those are macroeconomic events, or the prices of goods, or the international trade is blocked, etc. Then third is political events. Politicians can make all kinds of good decisions, and sometimes they make very bad decisions. And last but not least, how is the public going to react? We cannot discuss all those events in total details, but I will just show you a case study where we go step by step through all those possibilities. Well, first of all, the stakeholders. How important are they? What kind of risk can they create? Can they give support, etc.? We discussed this already, so I go very quickly over those slides. I show this, for example. There are many stakeholders, but I will focus in this presentation mainly on the actions of the clients and the actions of lenders. And there are many more possibilities, of course, but then just to show how it works out. Then you hopefully understand the mechanism behind it. Yeah, sometimes I look to my other screen. I have two screens, so if you think, what is he doing? I'm looking at my other screen. So here you see, and it is in the guidance which you received earlier. I'm not going to discuss it. Clients, board, staff, etc. can cause risks, and they can give support. So I'm not going to discuss it, but you remember probably what we discussed here. Then the second thing is macroeconomy, decreased trade, lockdown business, inflation, depreciation of the currency. Those are some possibilities. And third is the political events and reaction of the public. Yeah? What is very important is security. What you see, and you saw that already in some countries, that people are just going to do plundering, or they commit fraud. Fraudsters find this an ideal environment to commit fraud, because there's a lot of chaos around. Maybe there are less controls. So what they do, they take advantage, and also they use false information to say, well, you here you have very good protection against corona, so please buy this, you know, and you know that is that's wrong. Okay, let's go to the scenario building itself. So basically, let's now switch. Let me see if I can do that. I'd like to switch to the. It's funny, it is not. 1 second, I have to open that again, apparently. There it is. Okay. So this is the Excel.
There is charge. Yeah. Okay. Good. Go ahead, Hans.
I have to switch, and sometimes I have to first open it again and then to share my screen again. So it's a little bit annoying, but that's how the system works. This is the Excel spreadsheet. As you can see here, there are a lot of tabs. In total, I think there are around 17 tabs. But don't be afraid. I mean, I will guide you through it step by step. The first slide is a very simple one. You know that already. That is the what we just showed, also showed on the screen. What kind of risks can clients and board, etc., cause? So I'm not going to discuss them. You know them from the guidance. Secondly. There are what is called the non-financial assumptions, and so basically what you do here is you take the generic possibilities of the first slide, and so what are possibilities, and here you can fill in What are the different things you want to take into account in the different scenarios. Okay, here's scenario one. If you go to the right, it is scenario two and scenario three. So this is an example how you can fill your own scenarios. Right? To say, okay, in this case, I say staff is 5% is ill.
Hans, sorry that interrupt, but I have somebody in the chat saying that it's not seeing the slides. Are you not seeing the screen? Well, there are two different persons, so let me see, because I'm seeing correctly. Can everyone just confirm in the chat that you are able to see the Excel sheet that Hans is showing? I have now one that says yes.
Maybe it takes a time.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, I think. Well, let's continue, because now I have a mixed group, but not yet. That is. Chat is clear, but voice is low. I don't know. Is my voice low or? Well, let's see. I have people that see it. I'm not sure. Perhaps for the people that cannot see it, please use a slider also to minimize the faces. Yeah, it's weird that you cannot see the. If you have all the. Yeah, let's see. Now I see that Hans has stopped sharing his screen.
No.
No? Because now for me it has stopped. So let's see, perhaps if you charge it again, Now, okay. Now I see the Excel. Can everybody see the Excel sheet that is in the screen? Because otherwise we'll have a yes, perhaps yes. Okay. For those that cannot see, our recommendation is to go off the session and start again. Because we can see it now. Okay, Hans, sorry, go ahead. Yeah, now I have a lot of yes. Okay.
Okay, like I said, this is what we saw before. So you can pick, it's like a menu, right? You can pick and choose for each scenario what you consider as possibilities. So for example, here, I just take an example and you say, okay, staff, 5% of the staff is ill and they're not available, or they went home or whatever, they have to take care of their family or something. In the next scenario, it is 10%, right? And you can imagine in the next scenario, it's maybe 15% or 20%. So you can basically play with those scenarios to basically say what is possible. So we have a, let's say, a light scenario, we have a heavy scenario, and we have a, let's say, a worst case scenario. So I would advise you to make at least three scenarios, varying from a mild scenario to a heavy scenario to what is called a worst case scenario. So you have to fill this in and basically to think what are the possibilities looking at stakeholders, like we just explained. Here lower you can see macroeconomic events and society. Yeah? So what as fraud and scams, what we just discussed. So this is like a kind of an introduction, yeah? So more verbally what you want to describe. And then I would like to go, I hope it works again. I go back to the PowerPoint. I hope it, maybe it takes a couple of seconds when I switch the screen. So sorry for that. So I will wait a couple of seconds to. So do you see this now? The
Yes, Hans.
PowerPoint?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Is there anybody who does not see the PowerPoint? Can you put it in the chat?
I'm not getting any message, so go ahead.
Right. So focusing on one of the most important stakeholders is obviously your clients, right? I mean, that's where your core of your business is. So what are possibilities for clients? What are, let's say, scenarios for your clients? I explained this before. I use this again now for the scenario. but just to show you more in figures how to do that, this in practice. But first, the theory, right? In case of the crisis as it is now, clients are different. Clients can be wonderful, right? Business as usual. It's a food shop. Well, everybody needs food, so they still can do their business and they are doing well, right? There are even business who do better, right? Maybe health, protection, soap, other things that are far more important now than before. They have a booming business. Here in the Netherlands, you see, for example, also business that is booming. Online shops, for example, are doing very, very well. So they have a bigger profit even. So some business profit from the crisis. But obviously, there are a lot more who suffer from the crisis. Their business is going down. Or even worse, the business is totally stopped. Because there is no demand anymore, or it is forbidden by the government, due to a lockdown. And of course, a full lockdown is very serious and that will affects far most of the business. So how to do that? How to make that inventory? Well, first of all, you have to look at two factors. One is, are they able to pay, right? And some clients are able to pay in this category here, and some are not able to pay. They can't, right? Their business stopped, so they can't pay, right? And then there's another factor which is very important. Are they willing to pay? Because even if you are able to pay, like I said before, some people make misuse of the crisis. They say, oh, my neighbor is not repaying. Ah, I don't have to repay either. My business is going well, but why should I repay? Because my neighbor is also not repaying, right? So I'm not going to repay. So they're able to pay, they're not willing to pay. And that is, of course, not acceptable, right? You should continue collection. You should have a kind of zero tolerance to that because it's normal business, right? They might even have better business. So that is not correct, right? But yeah, the ones who are not able to pay, they might be willing to pay. So like, and they ask you, can I get some restriction of my loan, or can I postpone, or I want to pay you back, but you see that my business is suffering, so I can't, and I have to feed my children, right? So they are in this category. So you can consider restructuring. And then finally, some business might go bankrupt, right? They are really out of business, and on short term, there is no any view that this business will start again, right? So you can say, and it's always a difficult line, like, is it a write-off or can we still restructure, right? Is it somewhere here? It's a black and white picture, of course. There are intermediate possibilities, but just to show you the general idea. So how do you do that? Because it's a nice story, Hans, but how do you do it in practice? Well, what you can do is make an inventory of your portfolio. Ask your loan category, your loan officers to, oh dear, why is this now popping there? Don't do anything. Oh dear. Does it go away? There we are again. So then make an analysis by means of your loan officers. Aggregate them and try to put them in these blocks. By the end of the session, I should not forget, there is a very nice questionnaire which has been made by an organization which I would like to share with you. It's a very extensive one, but you can make a kind of inventory of your clients in order to get a better view of how they are dealing with the crisis. So you aggregate it, you make the analysis, and you quantify it. And you can take into consideration, for example, the health of your clients, and also whether they are positioned in the rural area or in the urban area. There might be a difference. So what do you do then? There might be a difference in the sector, right? Is it agri, is it garment, is it trade, etc.? Are there additional income sources, like they have a job, a paid job, they have remittances, but remittances might be suffering as well. Geographically, what I just explained, where are they living? Is it in the rural or urban area? So all those factors might play a role to see in which category of those colored graph they belong. So what you could have as a result when you gather all those details of your loan officers, you can say, hey, well, we have 20% of the clients have business as usual, 10% have increased business, they do better, 50% have a decreased business, and 20% have no business anymore. Right, so you can translate it in those vectors. See? Okay, so I would like to go back now to the Excel again. Is there anybody who does not see the Excel?
I'm not getting any reply in the chat, and I see it correctly, so.
Okay. Well, here you see in the Excel exactly what I just explained. So I don't have to re-explain it again, but you can see the same picture in the Excel. So I will come back to it later. So first we have, this is a very, very simplified example, but just to show you the mechanism, how it works, I will first explain this MFI, let's say with a normal cash flow, a normal business, and that, because I use this as a basis for the analysis further, for the scenario analysis. So this is a normal cash flow, as you can see, a very simple one. The loan collection, it's a total loan portfolio of 183 million. The term deposits which they have, which can come out in 2 months' time, 3 months' time, etc. There's other inflow, or maybe fees or whatever. There's a short-term loan which will come in 3 months' time. So here you see the total inflow, right? This is the total amount. Then on the outflow side, the loan disbursements. I made it very, very simple, just to don't make it too complicated. Just because it's not important how those figures exactly are. It's just an example. But what is important, I hope to convey to you how to play with those figures. Those figures are totally not realistic. It's a very short cash flow. Of course, I know that you must have far more bigger, but it goes about the picture, that you have the idea how to do it. So in this case, miracle, the loan collection and the disbursements are exactly the same. Well, of course, that's not realistic, but just to show what the effect is. There are term deposits outstanding, so of your clients, right? The savings, you don't see it here, but there are savings of the clients. Why does it not show in outflows? Well, normally, savings, if you have a deposit-taking institution, or even when you have voluntaries, let's say voluntary savings, then normally that is growing. In a normal situation, people take money out, money in the savings account, but on a general overview, there is a kind of a core savings that remains stable. It does not go down, and normally people want to save, so it's over time, it is gradually growing. So that's why you don't see it here in this line. But we will see the effect later, because if people need the money, they are going to collect it. So here you see, well, there is a repayment to the bank, repayment to lenders, tax payments in a half year time, some operating expenses, and a total outflow. And here you see the cash in bank, other assets which are there, the starting balance, the change in cash position is basically this minus this, right? And that in the end balance is that in the next months, this is the starting balance. The difference between the inflow and the outflow is 500,000. So that's the new balance, etc. So that goes further. Very simple, right? I talked about what is called a liquidity gap analysis. That is basically, of course, exactly the same figures, but now making use of the balance sheet. So So what is the difference between a cash flow and a liquidity gap analysis? The cash flow is basically money in, money out, right? You know that. The liquidity gap analysis takes your balance sheets as a starting point. So here you see, right, in the last column, this one, that is the balance sheet. So you have assets and you have liabilities. And of course, a balance sheet is in balance, right? That's why it's called the balance sheet. However, and it's like a snapshot, huh? It is like a picture. You do a balance sheet of one particular moment, and that is it. However, the balance sheet is in fact only in balance at one particular point of time. But when you are one day later, or 2 days later, or a month later, then the balance sheet looks differently. What do I mean by that? Well, we just saw in the cash flow, for example, that there are here term deposits which you have put as an institution on the bank. So you put money aside and you will get it back in 2 months. Well, that you see here as well, right? So what you basically do is you put more or less the cash flow in. Can reflect it in your balance sheet because of this amount, the total amount of your term deposits, the outstanding amounts, which you have put at the bank is 30 million, but you don't have it available now. You have it only available in 2 months, right? So you split, you tear apart your balance sheet into time buckets. Basically, exactly the same as you see here. That's also time buckets, right? The difference is that you do see the cash here, right? The cash is in your balance sheet, right? Also, what you see here is your equity, and your retained income. So your total equity is also in a balance sheet. You don't see equity in the cash flow, right? So that's the difference. But the figures are exactly the same. So what you see here is the total assets, the total liabilities, and here you see other income and short-term loan inflow, etc. And finally, you can make exactly the same exercise. You do assets minus liabilities. You take into account the other inflow and the other outflow, and you calculate the total gap between the inflow and the outflow, and that results finally in a gap, and you can make, like I saw before, a cumulative gap, so like 11 million positive, because if you calculate this, it's positive. When you go to the next month, well, hey, there's a negative one. So as you can see, 11 million minus 500,000 is then 10 million, etc. So that works further through. The second thing, what I want to explain, is you can translate that into what is called a gap as a percentage of the equity. So you can to say it is the equity is here, right? And how much is this amount of the total equity? And that is kind of a ratio. You can say, well, is it really a bad thing? Is it only 1%? Or in this case, for example, it is minus 8. Well, that is not so good. It is a minus. And this is, well, 1% probably you can handle that. That's not so important. So I hope that you understand a little bit the difference between a cash flow and a liquidity gap. It's not rocket science. It is quite comparable. The only thing is that you, in a balance sheet, you have your cash and you have your equity, and you don't see that, of course, in your cash flow. Why do I present this? Because why don't we only use the cash flow? Well, the point is that for a liquidity gap analysis, you have a little bit more overview of the effects on your equity, and you have a longer term view. Normally, the cash flow is done at much shorter periods. I show it here, like I said, very simple, also in months to make it comparable, to make it easy. But normally a cash flow, and especially in this crisis, I would like to stress that, is do that at least for the first 4 weeks per week and not per month. A cash flow in a crisis situation, you should do the short term, definitely not on a month basis, but on a week basis. And some even do it on a daily basis, right? So so the best would be, I would say, weekly basis, maybe for the first month, and maybe even better for the first 3 months, to say 13 weeks you do, and then you can go over to, and it is a rolling process, so after 1 week it goes to the next week, etc. So I hope that this was clear. I just wonder, Andrea, should we allow a little bit for questions now, because this is important?
It's up to you, Hans. We haven't received any question in the chat, so I don't know if anybody has a question of this first section that you want to share.
We can postpone it to later, because I'm going to explain the other types of cash flows and liquidity gaps. But there is if there is a very burning question, then we can handle it now.
But I haven't received. Yeah, the chat is clear, so move ahead, okay. And we can take other questions later.
Okay, then we can go to the. What I explained already, the client segmentation. Well, like I said, I made three scenarios. A scenario which is mild, more or less, a scenario which is heavy, and what I would call a worst case scenario. So here I made an example of, you see here the same picture, right? The total outstanding portfolio was, like we saw, 183 million. And here we see the mild scenario. So the total amount of the portfolio is 183 million. And okay, 155 million is in the green area, so they're able to pay. And they're willing to pay. Great, right? And surprise, it is exactly 85%, also to make it simple, right? And in the orange area, people are able to pay, but are not willing to pay. So there are 300 clients with a total amount of 9 million where you have difficulty. And the same for not able to pay, but willing to pay is also 5%, and there is a group of 5% who cannot pay and are not willing but also not able to pay. So this is the first one. Here you see the variation. So imagine that you say, well, for the green one, I expect that 100% can be collected. So of those 155 million, I can collect 155 million. Here, in this area, you have to put extra effort to collect. And in spite of the enforced collection activities, on the short term, you're only able to collect 95%. Because some are saying, no, I can't, and blah, blah, blah. And it takes time, right? It takes longer time than normal. So let's imagine that you only, for a short term, can only collect 95%. Then the yellow area, they are have more difficulty. You can only collect 80%. Eh? They say, yeah, I can only pay. Some pay 90%, some pay 70%, some pay nothing. So let's say for the simple scenario is 80% cannot, it can be collected. And the red point is they cannot collect at all. It cannot be collected at all. So when you use those percentages for these amounts, right, then you see, okay, this can be collected 100%, right? The green area. This, you see the formula here, right? It's basically the 9 million times the 95% results in 8,600,000. Likewise, this amount, right, is the combination of 9 million times 80%, so you only can collect 7 million. And here, obviously, nothing can be collected. So in total, instead of collecting 183 million, you're only able to collect 171 million, which means instead of collecting 100%, you only collect 93% of the total outstanding amount. So that's the mild scenario. So let's see how that works out. And that's not the only thing that changes, right? So this is just how to deal with those able to pay and not able to and not willing to pay issues. So here is the first scenario. So what I just saw here, right, is you can collect 93.75%, which means you cannot collect 6.25, right? So you see that back here. 6.25 you cannot collect. So that has its effect on, yeah, your cash flow has its effect on your liquidity gap analysis. So the second thing is the short-term loan is withdrawn. The short-term loan, which is promised to be issued in 3 months' time, remember, was here. You would collect, you would get, hey, there was a promise to collect 20 million. Great. That is not done anymore. Okay, so this short-term loan, which was promised, is not there anymore. So you have to take that into account. Furthermore, clients need to save. Remember that they talked already about savings. Normally they are stable or even grow in a normal situation. And now people need the money, right? Maybe the people in the orange area, right? They say, okay, or in the, what is it? Yeah, in the orange area. They're not able to, they only can repay you by means of their savings, right? So they withdraw 15% in the coming 3 months. So in the first month, they collect 15%. In the second month, they collect 15%. And in the third month, they collect 15%. So that means that your savings go down as well. So here you see, and we have distributed that here you can see, let's say, the assumptions. How does it translate? We saw this before in that other Excel sheet. So you the percentage of repayments and the portfolio size of the portfolio. Well, 100% times this amount is this, etc., etc., etc. This is the total collection you can do, and here you see the other assumption, like savings withdrawals, for example, 15% per month for the first 3 months, etc., and the tax expense, etc. Here you can see all the other things. How does that work out in your cash flow? Well, what you see here, it is exactly that amount, that reduced amount of loan collections, right? You're not able to collect anymore 183 million. You're only able to collect 171 million. The disbursements, you keep on going to disburse the same amount. So obviously, you disburse more than you get in. So that means a gap, of course. The next thing what is changed is the 20 million which you would receive is not there anymore, right? And there was another one, right? No, that was it, eh? So the lower collection, the savings that go down, you see here, it is an outflow of 15% of the total amount of savings. 15%, 15%, 15%. So that's another outflow. So three factors. Your loan collection is lower. You miss the inflow of the short-term loan that was here, right? Remember that was here. You saw the 20 million, right? Maybe look at the cash flow here. It's gone, right? This amount is gone. So three factors, one, two, and three. That means, of course, effect on the gap. You see already a big difference. Here you saw an inflow of, oops, the end balance was this, and here it is. There is a difference, I think. Oops. Oh, what is happening here? It jumps out suddenly. The liquidity gap is similar. Here I highlighted the changes. So the client loans is less. You see the minus, right? Because it used to be the same amount and now it's less. So the total amount you can see here. Screen. Here you see it was this amount, but you see it has been reduced to 171 million. So that's one. The short-term loan is gone, right? It's empty. And the savings, you see the withdrawals. So that ends up in a lower cumulative gap. Okay, that was his first scenario. The second scenario, imagine that we had here client segmentation was here 85%, 5%, 5%, 5%. In this one, this more heavy scenario, it's not 85% anymore, but only 75% of the clients can repay. Not 85% of the clients can be in can are willing and able to pay. It's not only more 5% of the total portfolio who are able to pay but not willing to pay. That's so that's also more serious. And this remains the same. And instead of not able and not willing to pay is not 5% anymore. It's 10%. So that works out in exactly the same way. So it's the same situation. This amount is a collection of, so that is this times that amount. You see, 95% of the new outstanding loan in the orange area, which is a lower amount. So that adds up in total, not anymore to 183, not anymore to 171, but 262 million, which is of the original outstanding amount, only 88.5%. Then we go here. What are the reductions? Oh, that is funny. That should be this. There is something. That is 85.5 minus or 100 min 85. That is, means 11.5% reduction in repayments. So what is the other difference? So this is the first difference. The short-term loan is withdrawn. That's the same. Client withdrawals is higher, right? 15%. Oh no, sorry, that's the same. And there's another factor, the overdraft facilities are withdrawn. So that works out also in the cash flow. Oh yeah. The overdraft facilities. Right. I forgot to do it here. I see. Yeah, sorry about that. That should be 14 then. 14 million. It's always difficult to make that fully consistent. So that's 14 million. And here you see it also, right? It is not anymore here and here. But the bank has said, sorry, you cannot repay your overdraft facilities between in the period 4 to 6 months, but you have to pay it now. Which means an other, let's say, increase of your gap situation. So in total, here you see the effect of the client loans. A lower amount is collected, has 11% less. The savings, 15% per month is withdrawn for the first 3 months, and the overdraft facilities, which is withdrawn. So those are the changes. Yeah, and of course the short-term loan. Eh? So 1, 2, 3, 4. Again, what is this? What does that do? I'm not touching that button. I don't know. It goes automatically. So that's the third one, the third change. And here you see again. The gaps, what is the cumulative gap? It becomes negative now, you see. Here you see already it is worse than in the first scenario. The first scenario was okay, cumulative gap only in the third block, it becomes negative. And here you see already in the second month it becomes negative and it goes worse, right? The total negative amount is in the end even 46 million, and here it was 37 million. So you see the situation is worse than before. Now we go to the final scenario. Here it's even worse, right? So this is, let me see, what is this? This is, let me see, this is 22. So in total here we have In total, we have 142 million instead of 183 million. So you see, this is even worse. So only 77% of the outstanding portfolio could be collected. Yeah? So that is, of course, changing the cash flow also. The loan collection is less here, you see, ending up in 142 million. The other key assumptions are reduction in payment of 22 million or 22%. The short-term loan is withdrawn, which we saw before. The withdrawal of client savings is not anymore 15%, but is now 25%. In the first 3 months, and like before, the overdraft facilities are withdrawn. So the change, the difference between scenario 2 and 3 is instead of a reduction of payments of 11.5%, it is now 22%. And the savings, the drawing, withdrawings of the savings is not only more 15%, but is now 25% in the first 3 months. So, and that will, as you can see, end up in a disastrous effect on the already in the first period, there's a negative cash flow and negative total the total amount. So even the current situation of the existing cash is not enough to pay for all the liabilities. So this is indeed the worst case scenario. You see, the amounts is only becoming very, very negative. So this is really, and you can say the same here for the liquidity gap analysis. It boils down to exactly the same amount. And as you can see, that is already 85% of the total equity, or in case you would say it is a full write-down, it is eating your total equity, so you're bankrupt, right? So, and there's another way to calculate it. The gap is 50% here of your total outflow, which is quite dramatic. So, yeah, that was about an hour. I've been talking a lot, and I can imagine that there might be questions in the meantime. So I hope this was, let me see if I have to show some other slides. 1 second. Yeah, then the last but not least, I want to show you the last slides. So what can you do? Because this is the negative part, right? Like, oops, what can go wrong? Of course, this is the basis to do your contingency planning. To say, okay, we cannot accept that negative amount, so what can we do? Right? Well, how can we try to prevent this, all those figures become negative? Well, first of all, of course, inflows up. So can you get a capital injection from your shareholders or your funders? Or a postponement of your capital to ask for grace periods? Or maybe postponement to pay the interest, right? If you have tax, maybe there's possibilities via your microfinance institution to get a tax deferral to say, okay, can we postpone the tax payment for this period? Maybe via NGOs or banks get emergency loans or grants. What you also can do is sale of illiquid assets. However, is that wise? First of all, who is going to buy, right? Because everybody is in the same situation. So when you want to sell, for example, land or buildings or whatever, or other assets, is there a market? And do you get a fair price for that? Yeah. So that is kind of touchy. Outflows down, expenses down. How can you reduce your expenses? Reduce and also investments. Eh? I mean, I did not talk about investment, but any investments in these periods, well, maybe it's better to postpone them. Reducing or stopping new disbursements. Yeah, that's the question, right? Renewals, as you know, if you are not going to renew loans for your clients, they might think, okay, then I'm not going to repay at all, right? If I don't get another loan, I'm not going to repay. Or when they hear that from their neighbor, right, then there might be a kind of reputation risk. So that is kind of touchy. At the other hand, in this situation, everybody understands that this is a difficult situation, so you might be able to reduce your disbursements gradually. Delaying payments, right? Asking for postponements. Lowering salaries, also a touchy point. You need your staff, right? If they are demotivated, are they going to work for you, right? So that's also something, and it's there was this morning an article in the papers here in the Netherlands that one supplier wanted to do that, but you know, you get a big effect of it. Capital spending is postponed, and well, not filling vacancies. So, or just those are some of the possibilities. So yeah, like I said, financial industry builds on trust. Yeah. So be aware that if you have voluntary savings, allow for that. Huh? Think of the reputation issues. Continue loan disbursement for certain clients. And for clients in real need, if you are able to do that, huh? Give them emergency loans and restructure. And again, what happens if you all or use all your client repayments for your funding of your business? You're out of business, right? So be careful with that. So let me see if there's something else. What is very important, of course, is communication to all your stakeholders, lobby. Don't forget about the security measures. Of course, your health measures, that's obviously. And yeah, analyze your business process, look. We talked about this before. What kind of business process can you stop? What can you reduce in intensity? For example, travel, group meetings, etc. What can you do more? Well, communication with stakeholders, monitoring by phone, etc. Having contact by phone, not visiting your client, but do it by phone. And yeah, hopefully, and in Africa, there's a big possibility to make use of mobile payments, etc. So this is a kind of thinking model to say, well, how do we have to change our business model? Hey, what can we reduce, and what can we, let's say, increase? Okay, final. Don't wait. Analyze your actual situation. Plus the three main factors. Define three scenarios from mild, medium, or mild, heavy to worst case. Translate it into effect on your cash flow, your liquidity gap, and make contingency plans. The good news is that everybody needs everybody. You need your clients, you need your staff, but they also need you. Funders need you also, right? So everybody is in the same boat. We have to survive this crisis together. Well, basically, I just wanted to show you one thing. I will share this with you. This is what I highlighted in the beginning. There is an excellent survey instrument developed by this organization, BFA Global. This is the link, but I will share it. And it's an excellent way of getting a view on your clients. I must say this questionnaire is far too long because it has 52 questions, so which is probably far too long. But at least you don't have to reinvent the wheel. So be helpful for you.